Listen.
Hello, Super Ninfriendos, and welcome to Monhun Raiwi on NVC. I am your temporary host, Seth Macy. Joining me today is the official IGN Monster Hunter Rise Hero Squad, Casey DeFreitas.
Hi.
Logan Plant.
Seth.
And the huntingest hunter of them all, Tom Marks.
Well, I wouldn't go that far. I think that was the first person you listed, but hello.
Okay, all right, fine. Well, we are talking about Monster Hunter, of course, but we're also talking about Super Nintendo World, new Super Nintendo Switch news, and of course, the forthcoming public murder of Mario. But let us get to the elephant in the room, or a creature that looks like an elephant. Aha, that's a little like a monster. And that's where you jump in and say, oh, you mean a nosaloth? I don't know.
What's the name of the mammoth guy? I can't remember.
I don't remember either. He's one of the fated four in Monster Hunter Generations, though.
Yeah.
Logan, do you remember?
See, that's
we're all terrible. We already failed. We already failed the first one. But you know what? Generations was like generations ago. So how am I supposed to remember that? Because the game we're talking about this week is Rise, in which I know all of those monster names off the top
and
of my
head. We are on the rise. And Tom reviewed Monster Hunter Rise, gave it an 8, which is, of course, great.
Great.
Tom, let's hear about Monster Hunter Rise. Your thoughts, please.
It's really fun. It's a blast. Seriously, it's like there are parts of it that don't, I think, hit quite as hard for me as others that ultimately left me liking World more overall.
Can you give an example?
Real quick. Interruption. It's Gammoth, which is what I thought it was, but I thought that was like, there's no way it's just mammoth with a G, so I didn't say it, but it
giant
it
mammoth.
It is.
Oh, I get it now. Okay.
That's some real Pokemon like ducklet naming right there.
Apologies. Please continue, Tom.
Yeah, no, so I think it's really fun. The distinction for me is I think the movement and the combat with the wire bugs and the mobility they bring is probably the best Monster Hunter has ever felt to me. It is incredibly fast. It is incredibly fluid. It's extremely fun. But then kind of a lot of the things around that are just like a little bit thinner, a little bit less fleshed out than World, a little bit. The word Joe Screbbles, our news editor in the UK, there's kind of less wonder to it. There's a little bit less mystery, a little bit less mystique. It's a little bit more gamey in certain spots, which is absolutely not a problem because it is a game and it's meant to be played. And that's why I still think it's a really, really, really great game. It's just why it didn't quite hit as hard for me as World or Iceborne. But yeah, I think that some of the changes they made in this game are just remarkably smart and remarkably fun. And others are just pretty dang fun. And like, that's absolutely not a scathing thing to say, right? Like,
what's one of the major changes that you really liked about this latest game?
The wire bugs is for those who don't know Monster Hunter or haven't been paying attention to the coverage, like they give you this basically rechargeable resource that lets you jump basically anytime, super long distances. It lets you climb any wall in the game or nearly any wall in the game. It lets you do these special moves that are either very fancy or very maneuverable. And then also it does this thing that's incredibly vital where now when you get knocked on your butt by a hit, you can just press ZL and B and immediately pop up off of the ground and have your weapon sheathed, and you can immediately re-engage or really, really quickly heal or walk away. And like all of that combined basically just changes the pace of Monster Hunter so significantly that like I think a lot of people think of Monster Hunter because of the earlier games as this slow plotting thing. And there still is a lot of slow moments where, like, if you're using a super heavy weapon like the greatsword or the hammer, you still do attack slower. You still do have to line up your shots, right? Like, that is a key part of those weapons. But a lot of the other stuff is just quicker now. And I think that's incredibly smart because it gives the game a much more action-y pace than something before that, the games before it. And I really, really love that.
And I've just played the demo, but I felt that
it even made getting to the monster more fun with both the wire bug and the Palamute, the dog that you can ride around the world. I felt that the map in the demo was really built around this wire bug mechanic, where there are walls that you can get over if you have two wire bugs plus the extra one you can pick up. Tom, did you feel that the maps further on in the game were also suited really well around that wire bug mechanic?
Yeah, definitely that they encourage you to use the movement in a lot of clever ways around the map. I think that's partly with, you know, the endemic life being hidden in all these little nooks and crannies, the speary birds, which are these little colorful stat buffs. I think the maps, it's funny, I really liked the maps a lot. They were like a little bit, it's funny to say this because there's so much verticality in the maps, but because you have so much control, they sometimes felt a little bit flatter, like functionally to me, because there was like, you could just go anywhere. So like there was a little bit less structure to them, which is really amazing and freeing and fun. It was just also like stylistically, they blend together very, very slightly more than something when I'm thinking of World, where like, the Coral Highlands is so unique and different from something like the Rotting Vale or something like the Elder's Recess. And they all have this sort of like personality to them. And now the personality in Rise is basically just Wirebug. And that's awesome.
Interesting.
Because that personality is wonderful, right? And I'm not talking visually, because visually they all are very distinct. But yeah.
It also just gives you an incentive to explore more, because exploring is just that much more fun. Mm-hmm. And you know, because you have the Wirebug and the Palamute to get around quickly, that going off on a detour isn't going to take so long. Yeah. And it will actually be a fun experience instead of just like, I guess I got to walk here now. Yeah. But speaking of that, there are still subcamps and things that you can find, so you can still do some fast travel and everything. But yeah, we were talking about this, like just the small addition of the Wirebug Fall makes the pacing for this game much faster, but it also makes it feel easier than previous Monster Hunter games, because in previous Monster Hunter games, you get hit, you are then knocked back and put in a vulnerable position where you can then maybe be hit again very easily. And with the Wirebug Fall, as long as your reaction is quick enough and you just go in the correct direction away from the monster, like you can just get right back up on your feet, heal, because you automatically sheath your weapon, and there's no longer this little mini game going on inside your brain. Okay, like, should I wait on the floor so I don't get hit again? When can I use my potion? And also, speaking of that, you can always just get on your Palamute and run circles around the monster while sharpening your weapon and while taking potions or whatever else you need to do, and have very, very little risk about getting hit. So just those two, the Palamute and the Wirebug, just makes it feel a little bit easier once you get the hang of it, because it is a lot of extra controls, even for people who have been playing Monster Hunter. But once you get used to it, yeah, it's very fun.
That was actually something I noticed when I was, because I was capturing footage for a review, like all the way through my 50 hours of playtime for this review. And one thing I was noticing when I was going back for the review to try to find good moments and good examples of things I was talking about is, when I was looking at footage that I captured in maybe the first 20 hours, I was using the Wirebug way less than when I was using than the last 20 hours of that footage, where I was using Wirefall basically every time I got hit back or hit, like knocked back. And then when I was looking at like the, you know, all the low rank stuff I was doing, I like barely ever used it. It takes a moment to really like realize how impactful that ability is.
And also, just to repeat it, he said it 20 hours, which I completely agree with. I don't feel comfortable with a weapon until I play with it for about that long, and with the Wirebug and everything. Like, I didn't get used to, I remember when I was playing the demo, I had put in maybe like 5 or 6 hours into just the demo, and I was talking to people and saying, I don't feel comfortable with this game yet. I don't know. I'm not using the Wirebug enough. I'm not doing this enough. And it took me around 15 or 20 hours before I felt really, really comfortable with the controls to look and feel like I knew what I was doing.
Yeah, it's still got, I mean, that's mm-hmm. a key thing about Monster Hunter, right? And Rise and World both together is like, World streamlined a ton of stuff, and Rise took a lot of that streamlining and continued it or adapted it or whatever. But like, neither game feels like it has removed depth. And I think Rise has actually added a little bit more depth with some of the customization you can do to the weapons. But like, there's still so much here to like dig into and learn, even if it is a more accessible game. That doesn't mean it is like a dumbed down version of Monster Hunter. Mm.
And I also
I was actually gonna ask, is this will probably be my first Monster Hunter, because I was playing the demo and it clicked for me almost. Cool. Like, I feel almost. Like I need the full game for it to fully click. But I also had Parker, who's really familiar, my son, really familiar with, he was like coaching me and helping me.
That's so awesome. That's how you should play Monster Hunter.
Yeah. And he was like, oh yeah, you gotta sharpen it up. You see that gauge up there? That means your giant guitar that you're using is getting dull. I was like, okay, all right, cool. Thanks, buddy. But I was gonna ask for Casey and Tom, like, is this a good one for people who maybe have wanted to get into Monster Hunter but you have just been too afraid of it?
Yeah, I was actually going to say, even though we said it took like 15 or 20 hours to feel like we're an expert with the controls, I don't want to turn away any beginners, because just because you're not an expert at using the wire bug and the controls doesn't mean you can't play the game. Like, I got through that the first 15, 20 hours of the game without needing to know those controls. Right. You know?
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah.
Mm-hmm, it's just was really cool when I... It's just Monster Hunter is a really unique, cool thing where when you do figure out something, it is just a really exciting moment that now you have a cool new tool in your arsenal that you could beat those monsters even better and faster now. Like, I played with the hunting horn for the first like 10 hours and I didn't realize that the R trigger... I've never played hunting horn in a previous Monster Hunter game before, so apologies if this is a known fact for previous hunting horn players, but the R trigger has invincibility frames, so you can actually dodge with that attack, and I didn't know that, and it completely like blew my mind and changed my world with that weapon. So like those like small little I guess discoveries just changes the way you play and makes it that much better, which is really cool. But Rise does it in a way where you don't necessarily need to know how to be a pro at a weapon to get through the story. So
so then on the other side of it, does, for longtime Monster Hunter fans, does that make the game too easy? Because I think back in my time with World, and there's these certain like checkpoints you hit in the story, like when you fight a Diablos and it just kicks your butt, when you fight the Nergigante and it just destroys you for a few times till you have to figure it out. Sounds like you two were kind of breezing through the story. Are longtime fans going to have challenge in this game?
Yeah, this is something Casey and I talked about, and we talked about a little bit before, but just generally throughout, is like, are we just better from having put hundreds of hours in World, or is this game easier? And I think when other reviews came out, a general sentiment is that this is an easier game, kind of overall. And I think there's a lot of factors that go into that, stuff like you can heal quicker, stuff like Casey was saying, where you can just sort of ride around on the dog if you need a break, like you can get out of there pretty easily, wirefall, things like that. So it is an easier game. And I was just saying this, but like, I think I only lost a single mission the entire time I played for the review. And that was because somebody was AFK and got killed accidentally while they were away from the game. Right. And like, so we were down a faint, and like, I've only fainted, like I can count how many times I fainted total on the like one hand. Right. Like it's definitely easier, but there were still moments that kicked my butt. I know exactly the moment you're talking about, especially like in World, like the first time you face Anjanath.
Yeah, that's the first one.
One shot you with a fireball, and you're just like, oh, great. Like that's like a body check of a moment. I never really felt like I had those in Rise. There are definitely points where you get up to higher rank stuff and it gets harder and you're like, dang, this is a harder monster, but it's never really to the degree of past games, I don't think. And I think that's sort of generally one of my, not issues, but like one of the shortcomings of Rise, is that it really is lacking sort of that last layer of like end game challenge to really push you and test you and use all of its systems really to their max and like really make you think about really in depth about what armor skills you're using and what weapons you're equipping. Like, you really don't have to think crazy hard about that stuff with the content that's in the game at launch, which is a little disappointing. Again, not a deal breaker because it took me 50 hours to get to that point, but just a little disappointing as like a, as someone who spent hundreds of hours in World.
Yeah,
was that 50 hours? Oh, I'm sorry, Casey. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I was going to ask, is that 50 hours just like your total playtime, or was that you stuck to the story? Because so, Bravely Default was 65 hours, and I barely deviated from the story at all.
No, so. No. So you could finish the story of this game quicker if you just focused on the story. And you, there is lots more for me to play in terms of like, there's a couple food item optional quests that unlock better food items that I didn't get. There's a couple of quests that unlock different moves that I didn't do yet. But like the way I described it in the review, which I think is the right wording for it, is it took me 50 hours to basically see everything there is to see in terms of like monsters and challenges and sort of variety. And that doesn't mean I'm sick of that stuff and I want to keep playing more of it. But like, I'm kind of running out of things where it's like the surprise element of it is like, okay, I've basically seen everything this game is going to throw at me, and now it's just the kind of classic Monster Hunter fun of, oh well, I want this item, so I gotta go fight a lot of this guy and that sort of stuff.
Right. Yeah, on. I can completely agree with that. Like, World, as you guys already said, World had many checks in place that kind of made you reevaluate the weapon you were using, reevaluate the armor skills that you had, reevaluate, you know, everything. Like, what am I doing wrong once you got to that point? And
what's going on with my life?
Yeah. What do I have to do? Like, when I first unlocked Kirin in Monster Hunter World, I said, you know what? This sucks. I'm going to learn a whole new weapon so I can kill this thing easier.
Yeah.
And in Rise, I never really had any moments like that. I kind of just made what I could when I could without a whole lot of extra effort. And keep in mind, I was repeating occasional quests because I was playing with some friends. So I did repeat a couple of things a couple of times, but there was never a point in Rise where I said, I need to master this weapon and I need a perfect armor set, or I'm going to have too hard of a time to continue. Like, my armor set at the end is trash. It is complete garbage. It accomplishes almost nothing. I have like a few points in like evade window and a few points in critical eye, and like it's not good. It's just what I could make at the time. I think I went out and purposely went to get a material once, and yeah, it was so I could make a better hunting horn. But
and crucially, if I may, mm-hmm, crucially, your armor set is that, and you could successfully use that for the hardest things the game can currently throw at you with no issue, right? Like, yes, that's the problem, is not just like, is that it does not ever push you to use its systems, even though its systems are really, really interesting and nuanced.
Yeah. Like, I could now go and grind to make a perfect, awesome set and perfect my use of the hunting horn. But right now, there's not really a reason to. But I do really want to emphasize they have a pretty substantial update planned for the end of April. And I assume that's when we are going to need those better armor sets and mastery over weapons, is to complete the extra content that comes out after, as is the case with previous Monster Hunters. I think the US has been a little bit spoiled as far as Monster Hunter content goes in recent Monster Hunter games. Like, so even Generations, like before Generations Ultimate, Generations on the 3DS was a celebration of all of Monster Hunter. So of course there were so many monsters and so many maps and so much content. And then Generations Ultimate was that plus a whole year of content plus a whole extra difficulty level. And 4 Ultimate was the base game plus a year of updates that Japan got, plus a whole extra difficulty level. So that's kind of what we've gotten used to here, is we get games when there's already been a year of support. So I think we can definitely expect the level of support plus some. I think we're getting extra. I think the updates are going to be bigger for Rise than they were for World, because World kind of already had a lot of really difficult challenges at the end, and then even more additional challenges in Tempered Monsters. So I definitely expect those challenges, and that's what I'm going to spend the next month doing, is preparing for what I expect to be those challenges. But I also wanted to mention, I'm not going to call out who, but I did read a review that said you could get to the end if you grinded a lot, and that wasn't my experience. So I guess maybe someone, like, maybe it will take you a lot of grinding. It just kind of depends on your comfort level of risk when going up against new challenges in Monster Hunter.
Right. Yeah. I think that's a great explanation of it. It's not something that longtime Monster Hunter fans or Japanese Monster Hunter fans will be unfamiliar with, right? This idea of like getting more through updates. But it is something that I think, like, we talk about World gets a lot of praise, and I got a comment of somebody being like, well, why do you bring up World so much? And I've said this before, I'll say this again. World outsold the previously best Monster Hunter by 11 million copies, right?
It's just insane.
The best selling Monster Hunter before was, I think, Try with like 4.5 million sold. That's a rough number, around there. And World sold like 16 million, right? It's not even... It's not even close, right? It is an insanely more popular game than anything Monster Hunter has ever put out before. So for a lot of people, I made a lot of comparisons to World because for a lot of people, World is all you know, right? World, for a lot of Monster Hunter fans, World is the only thing you have reference to. And World made a lot of improvements to Monster Hunter that were not just streamlining mechanical stuff like whetstones and healing, right? Like... It made a lot of improvements to the fact that its world felt very like congruent, and you would explore this island in an interesting way that where it's like, oh, the Coral Highlands were behind this ravine where we fought this specific monster. That's really neat. Oh, the Rotting Veil is under the Coral Highlands very specifically, and you can see things falling from above into it. Like, that's really, really cool. And World also did really interesting things, but or like gave people endgame content very quickly, right? Like, it did a lot of things that people are gonna kind of expect from this game that Rise just sort of doesn't do. And like, it doesn't do it to the point where it's a catastrophe. It's just that it doesn't do it. And so as someone coming only from World, there are going to be noticeable things where you're like, oh, this is a little bit thinner than that, right? Like, this is a little bit flatter than that experience. And
yeah, that's why I think Monster Hunter is in a really interesting space right now, because World just changed the whole game. And like you said, Tom, brought in 10 million new people who hadn't really played this thing before. And it's a very different game than something like Generations Ultimate, which is a much more difficult, hardcore game. And I think that it's a game that's trying to please a lot of people with what it has to offer, because there's some fans that want that grind and that really hardcore challenge. And then there's some fans who just want to breeze through the 20 to 30 hour story and then put it down. So I think it's in a really unique place in a post-World landscape for the series.
Yeah, it's feels almost like parallel evolution to a certain extent, where like this, that's why I called it like a sidestep from World. Cause I think it feels like Capcom trying to get the Switch audience onto the same sort of like footing as the PC, Xbox, and PS4 audience, or PlayStation audience that had World, where it's now it feels like Capcom being like, okay, we need to get everyone who didn't play that, who only played Generations Ultimate or whatever, kind of, we need to get them these features so that the next thing can make more sense and not out of the blue. And maybe that's a little, you know, underselling it or short selling it, but that's kind of what it feels like a little bit, is like a stepping stone at times.
I also am not entirely sure how to articulate my feelings about it, because I think, so on one hand, sure, I guess I'm like slightly disappointed that I didn't have those walls and those challenges that I was able to conquer and feel super awesome about. But at the same time, I think the combat is just more fun.
Yeah.
The actual combat is just more fun. So yeah. I'm just going to give Capcom and Monster Hunter the benefit of the doubt that those challenges are going to come later. And in the meantime, I had this really awesome, fun game with super cool mechanics that I can then use on more difficult challenges in the future.
Yeah. And that's the trick of it, right? It's because I've seen some people, some other like YouTubers or reviewers being like, this is my favorite Monster Hunter ever. And like, I 100% understand that, like, when it comes to the combat and the mechanics of the fighting, I agree. I think this is the best Monster Hunter has felt to me in the heat of the moment. But like, then there are other things that I think don't make it my favorite ever compared to World, right? But I 100% understand that, because it's like, yeah, man, the combat is just so much fun in this game. It is an absolute blast. So I totally feel that.
I got one more thing before we move on. I played the demo, like I said, and I was really impressed with the graphics, because they looked, especially for the Switch, and I didn't see any stuttering. Is that level of graphical fidelity, does that carry through the full game? Or did you run into any hiccups? Like, that kind of is what Hyrule Warriors sort of fell off for me, because it stuttered a little bit more than I was really wanted it to. I mean, who am I to talk? I've been playing A-Train, but still, I'm wondering if the are the graphics, do they hold up?
I think so.
Yeah.
The only time I ever noticed any frame stuttering was when we were playing with like four people, and there was everybody attacking at once with particle effects, and we were either next to like water or smoke or some other type of particle effect. And even then, it was only like very, very slight slowdowns, right? And that was super infrequent in very specific cases. Largely, this game, I think, runs incredibly well, looks really good. I really didn't like that the levels were very sort of like monotone in color, but then I realized that that's partly because when you're playing on handheld, having them be monotone makes seeing stuff like endemic life and monsters easier, right? Because they pop more on the monotone backgrounds. The load times are freaking insane.
They're magic.
Fast. They're like
that's awesome.
Like I'm not exaggerating when I say they are PS5 fast.
Oh wow!
It is quicker sometimes in the town to fast travel to a thing you can see than walk there. Like, it is that fast. Unbelievable.
It's one of those things where if you accidentally click something down the menu, you're not super upset because you know what? You can fix it in a second. Whereas in Monster Hunter World, if you accidentally tried to fast travel somewhere that you didn't mean to, it's like, well, there goes 10 minutes of my life. That's an exaggeration, but you know what I mean?
I think it might actually load into missions. Like, from the time you click a mission to the time you land in it, I think is faster than World on PS5, because I've played World on PS5 and
same.
I think that even has more load time than this. Like, it is.
That's amazing.
Fast.
That is.
Mm-hmm.
And that's crucial in a game like this, because that's kind of the whole point of Rise, right? Is like, get you in the mission, get on your dog, go fight the monster, right? And the fact that it has such load times makes that there's so much less friction to doing that. It's really amazing. So yeah, like performance wise, this is pretty dang impressive.
Oh, yeah. I also wanted to mention this Monster Hunter Rise does online incredibly well, like better than any other Nintendo Switch game I've played. It's amazing. I don't know why other games don't.
Not the highest
like
bar,
this.
But yeah.
But still.
A pretty low bar.
It's like the anti-Animal Crossing.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You can look at your friend list while in Monster Hunter Rise and then just join their lobby or invite them to your lobby. If you play with someone random, you can look at their Nintendo Switch profile and send them a friend request. If you like someone that you've played with, there's like a like system. You can then see a list of the people who have mutual likes.
Oh and my God. Like, it's Xbox Live circa the launch of the 360. Yeah. Holy cow.
The it's only the thing it's missing is voice chat, but everything else is perfect.
Yeah. It's the type of thing that we like shouldn't be praising. But it's great. It is.
Hey, when it hits. I mean,
yeah.
Well, that was, we were talking about the Monster Hunter Rise review, which Tom reviewed, gave an 8. Please go check out his full review for his full thoughts. Casey, I'm sure you have a few guides that people can check out, especially people like me who will be visiting those guides a lot. And then I have a question, Logan, for you.
Yeah.
Are you getting Monster Hunter tomorrow when it comes out?
I'm getting it tonight when it unlocks it. Yeah, I got it digitally installed.
Are you getting the day off for Monster Hunter Rise release day?
Yeah, I am not working on Friday, so I've got the entire weekend.
Are you working for the Japanese company that has Marco Unlimited that has given its employees a holiday? That's the next topic.
That was a good segue.
Yeah. It was.
Thank you. Tech developer Marcon Limited realized that a lot of the company employees were requesting to take the day off. Actually, I guess that would be today because Japan, I think, is 14 hours ahead of me. So, company leadership said, you know what? Official company holiday. Everybody just stay home, hunt monsters, have a great time. I like this note that Logan put in here. Employees have been grateful for the decision. Yeah, hell yeah, that's awesome. Any thoughts from any of the
you know? The Rise hype is just insane in Japan. So Stealth on Twitter has been on this show. He's been tweeting Amazon Japan rankings for sales. And it's like number one is Monster Hunter Rise Digital. Number two is Monster Hunter Rise Physical. Number three is the Switch Pro Controller. Number four is the actual Switch itself. It's like the top, like over half of the top 10 is all Monster Hunter
Amazon
related stuff. It's crazy.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I don't think we'll see that sort of level of excitement here in the States, but I mean, Switch will definitely be the biggest selling console again in Japan.
And it also makes some amount of sense, right? Because Rise is sort of feudal Japan themed,
yeah,
and has like references to Oni and sort of Japanese folklore in its monster designs. And so I think that is predictably hitting a chord with that audience in a very significant way.
I wonder what the final sales numbers will be. What are you going to say, Casey?
They're going to be insane. I heard rumors that Masaki Hayama, the person who made the decision also wanted to take the day off for Monster Hunter Rise.
See, that's good leadership right there. You don't want to do, you don't want to subject the people below you to something that you wouldn't do yourself. So he said, you know what? I want to stay home and play Monster Hunter, so I'm going to let all of my employees stay home and play Monster Hunter. That is great. If you're looking for a job in Japan, Mark Unlimited will give you a free holiday the next time Monster Hunter comes out. Maybe. I can't promise that.
If I didn't have to write guides, I too would be taking off tomorrow because, just as an example, I think, when did the new 3DS come out? What year was that? 2013?
That was 2014. The new 3DS. I don't actually remember.
I think it was 2015.
It was 2015. Okay. Right. I remember the date. It was February 13th, which was a Friday. And I took that day off because I got my new Majora's Mask 3DS and Monster Hunter 4 Ultimate. And I took that day off and it was a wonderful weekend.
That's a very collectible version of the 3DS, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
All of
it's
those
beautiful.
Zelda. Yeah, it is. It's one of the best ones. I wish I had gotten it, but.
I bought that one and the Monster Hunter 3DS and
another collectible one.
I couldn't keep both of them. I had to pick one and I chose to go with Majora's Mask. Oof. Sorry, Monster Hunter.
Some Sophie's choice.
It was prettier.
Well, yeah, it is much better. But if you're going to be staying home tomorrow for Monster Hunter Rise, just say something in the YouTube comments. We would love to hear from you and your adventures hunting monsters. And don't forget to check out the guides.
Thank you.
Some sad news, shifting gears here completely, going from we were in sixth gear, we're in a supercar, now we have to go in full reverse because Mario is going to die on March 31st. I'm sorry, but it's true. Nintendo has officially announced that Mario will be publicly murdered in a town square. The town is yet to be determined. They're looking for something that's thematically appropriate for such an icon to lose his life. That's not really what's happening. That's just what sort of the internet latched onto, because as you might have known, Mario's 35th anniversary, all the celebratory stuff stops on March 31st. Sort of, kind of. You won't be able to buy the codes online anymore, but if you have a code, you'll still be able to redeem it. Same if you like went into a store. I don't even know, do they sell cards with like codes on them still, or do they just sell like codes that you load up eShop with?
I think they did get rid of that a while ago and are just doing the eShop.
Okay. Yeah. But like, if you have a code right now and you haven't redeemed it, like, they're not going to punish you if you redeem it on, you know, April 3rd. It's also not going to burst into flames in your hands as you're trying to read it out. It's just basically all the fun stuff. Super Mario 3D All-Stars, Super Mario 35, which is the Battle Royale game, and the Game & Watch, which actually isn't digital, but those will all no longer be available. Whatever is out there in the wild, when it runs out, it's gone. I highly recommend, if you do have Mario 35 excitement and you haven't sated it yet, you go on to the get your Club Nintendo rewards. Like my fun little pencil case.
Oh, you got it.
It just came in. And my posters that were much smaller than I actually expected. But that's okay, because as you can see behind me, space is at a premium here. If you're watching on the video, you know that I have trash everywhere. If you
Don't
are
call
only
that
a listener,
trash. They're valuable collectibles.
I have valuable. Essential these aren't items. Toys, they're action figures.
Memorabilia
and things of that nature. And so I'm actually kind of glad that the posters are probably, they're like 10 by 24 inch instead of, I thought they're going to be, you know, massive. So it is still possible to get your Super Mario 35th anniversary fix. But sadly, Mario will be no more, and it'll be wiped from the history books after that, actually. And we'll talk about it, and no one will know what we're talking about. It's going to be a weird Twilight Zone episode going on. But did you, I throw to the panel, have you gotten all of your Super Mario 35 needs fulfilled? I mean, you only have a week left, less than a week.
I'm mad.
Mad?
Yes.
Please, because elaborate.
Nintendo's skeezy, false scarcity tactics working on me.
You know what's better than...
No. Let me finish.
False scarcity is much better than real scarcity, which is what we have with the PS5, and people can't get them, and they cost $1,200 on eBay. So give me some fake scarcity instead of the real stuff.
Here's what I'm mad about. Right. I've said on this show that I have not bought 3D All-Stars because I don't care. I don't need 3D All-Stars. I can play all these games still on other platforms, and I'm disappointed by the fact that it costs $60 for not too many improvements otherwise, right? I've said that, and that's, you know, you can disagree. That's totally fine. I'm happy if you disagree with that. And I'm
good. Then you should be real, real happy.
I'm happy if you're having fun with them on Switch, or if they're the only way you can play them or anything like that. That's great. I don't mean to belittle any of that. But for me, I don't really have any reason to buy this thing. And I don't really like the way it's being handled. So I just abstained. Now it's a week out from when I can never buy it ever again for no good reason. And I'm looking at it going, should I pay $60 for that thing, though? Because maybe what if I want to play it in 6 months? Like, and that's exactly why they're doing this.
Oh, yeah,
that's
they get their hooks into you now.
Yeah, that's why they're limiting the supplies, because they want people to feel like they have to get it now. And now I'm, like, debating about whether I need to buy it or not when I was very happily not owning it a week ago, right? Like, I don't know. I'm just like annoyed because it's exactly I'm falling into the trap mentally of exactly what I don't like about it, right?
That and fear of missing out. Yeah.
Right.
And there's a reason Nintendo's been in business for 130 some odd years. They're very good at business, as you might have noticed. Well, Super Mario 35 going off. That's fine. I mean, I reviewed that. I gave it a 7. It's kind of a bummer as far from like a historical preservationist point of view, because it's sort of like Ultra Hand, that Club Nintendo reward that was on the Wii U that you can never play again unless you happened to have had the points and cashed any. You can never play Ultra Hand. You'll never be able to play Super Mario 35 officially again. But Casey, did you get your Super Mario 35 fix?
Yeah. I mean, I would be I would be in exactly the same boat, but just to be transparent, I did get a code for Super Mario All-Stars from Nintendo.
So that won't be collectible, though.
I am not in a moral predicament because I did not have to spend money on it.
Well, okay.
But yeah. I feel like I would have been in exactly the same boat as Tom, right? Because I mean, I have access to all of those other games already, but at the same time, I also know that most of them will be in storage a majority of the time, especially living in tiny places in expensive cities. So it's just that much easier to have it on the Switch, but to have that false scarcity is just kind of...
Yeah, it's a tiny cart that's designed specifically for tiny city apartments.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So I'm just
Instead of needing all of my other stuff.
You need the CRT for the N64. It's just forget about it. It's a whole mess. Logan, are you mourning the death of Mario?
No, I'm actually not. I'm more mourning the loss of Fire Emblem, which is also getting delisted on after March 31st. The Shadow Dragon and the Blade of Light, the first time the original Fire Emblem has been translated into English, and they're just pulling it. And that one is more egregious to me because there's not really a physical copy of it. There was that physical limited edition, but it only came with a download code for the game. So it's like, this is a fully translated relic from the Famicom era. And now if you didn't buy it in this 6 month window, because it only came out in December, I think. So it's actually only a 3.5 month window. That one bothers me more than the Mario stuff does. And like 3D All-Stars, I mean, you're going to be able to play these games again in the future. They're going to be on future Nintendo platforms, but this neat little Fire Emblem project, I don't know if it's going to return. I hope it does, but Yeah, it's that one bothers me more.
Get rid of it. It doesn't make any sense. The good news is it's only $5.
So yeah, so $5, go buy that one. If you have enough
like Nintendo points, you could probably cash them in and mm-hmm. pick that one up if you're interested. I bought the special edition. It's in scattered pieces. I actually, the little crystal cartridge I damaged trying to show it off here on the show first got it. Yeah, I dropped it on the cement floor of my basement and cracked the edge of it. So,
no.
I'm like,
to me, the guy who,
I am about
whose job
to
it is
to here.
I mean, I wouldn't have bought it if it wasn't for the fact that my job is to like partially to monitor stock, and it came into stock and I was like, click, I'm getting that before it goes 5 minutes later. So, I mean, I tweeted it out first, of course, but mm-hmm. yeah, that was a bummer. But yeah, if you can get it, get it. If you have any interest in them, I recommend checking out Fire Emblem, actually, especially for $5 or your Nintendo points, because it's a very interesting game. It's hard to play in 2021 because it is a very much a product of its time, but it's still a super cool NES game, so check it out before it goes away. That was Mario 3D All-Stars, Super Mario 35, and the Game & Watch, which you can probably still find in stores. I went to a Target the other day and they had like 10 of them, and I recommend getting one of those too, because cool. those are super charming and wonderful and very difficult to hack. So that's it. Mario will actually not be dying on April 4th. April Fools! Oh, that's what they did to us. Oh, I feel like a fool.
I wonder
right
how
now.
Mad people would be
if they just killed Mario.
No, like they can't come around on April Fools and be like, just kidding. It's going to be on the eShop forever.
I think that would make people even more mad than if they've just.
Yeah, that's worse.
At this point. Yeah, like the old switcheroo. You don't want to do that. That's a confidence man trick.
Or they come out on April 1st and be like, surprise, here's fully remastered, fully remade versions of all of three of these games.
Yeah, I mean, that...
For $60 a pop.
They're not going to do that.
Right. And it comes with a new level, and Mario has a new hat. Oh, I guess he did, actually, in Odyssey.
The hat sold me.
The hat, that's what you want. All right, everyone on your NVC bingo cards, hit your free space, because we're talking about Super Nintendo Switch rumors. If you listened last week, we decided that it's going to be called Super Nintendo Switch. From Ed, Casey's getting up and leaving because she says
I'm
Switch
done.
For life. She does not want to listen to talk about Super Nintendo Switch. But unfortunately, they're becoming less rumors and more they're less fanciful rumors, and they're much more believable, intelligence that sounds pretty much like we're getting the Super Nintendo Switch this
I believe you
holiday.
I'm just tired.
Just
tired to talk about the Switch.
I mean, every week there's a new credible source. This one came from, I don't have the source written, I believe this was a Bloomberg report.
I believe so.
Yeah, it's going to be it's an upgraded NVIDIA chip. Currently has what, the Tenga M1? No, I'm thinking of the Apple computer, whatever. It has a chip in it by NVIDIA now, but this is a better new version offering, quote, better graphics and processing. It supports NVIDIA's DLSS rendering, which somebody in the comments was asking about or was talking about last week. And it could be released
this fall.
2021. Oh!
Dang. Got it wrong.
That.
Oh, holiday.
Is not great, and I am only saying that because the Xbox and the PlayStation 5 came out holiday, and from my perspective at work, it was a nightmare to try to get those out so people would know. And from my perspective as somebody who wanted a console, who has friends who still don't have one of those two consoles, and who watches the comments, the sad, like devastated comments every time they come in, and then it's like 30 seconds later, it's like out, sold out, gone. No, I don't really want a holiday release in this climate, because there are, it's still hard. Logistical considerations are making the whole supply chain impossible. The PlayStation 5 has transistor shortages that are only going to get worse. And I have to imagine that is not just that transistor, but there's some supply side issue. So as much as I would love to be playing my Super Nintendo Switch underneath the Christmas, underneath the mistletoe, and just smooching that OLED screen. I kind of don't want to have to go through another console cycle unless they are confident that they can, you know, meet demand, which
I know. Yeah, well, we saw the 1 million a month target was what they were trying to produce, I think, with one of the first rumors that we saw a couple weeks ago from Bloomberg. Yeah. But I don't know, Seth, maybe you can give insight on this since you do the IGN deals, but kind of a theory that if it does come out this holiday, they might be easier to find than we anticipate, because PS5 and Xbox Series X and S came out last holiday, but there were none available, like you said. And so this is kind of going to be their first big holiday season. There are still millions of people who want these things that don't have them, that I could see their dollars going towards those systems rather than just a half step upgraded Switch. And maybe this holiday, it's more of the Nintendo hardcore faithful that buy everything this company puts out. I'm talking about myself and everyone else on this show. Right. That
Day one Wii U, maybe.
Yeah, for sure. That would go out and get this on launch when other people, families, kids who are like, hey, can we get this new Switch? Parents say, we just got you the other Switch. What's different about this one? Yeah, exactly. So I can see it maybe being easier to find given the new consoles are still the hot thing. And out of the 80 million people that have a Switch, only a fraction of those people are probably going to want to be day one upgrades.
That is a very good point, and I think there is probably some merit to that. But at the same time, Nintendo is such, the Switch is just such a force to be reckoned with at this time. And yeah. I mean, was it last year around when Animal Crossing came out, and you could not get a Nintendo Switch because everybody wanted Nintendo Switch, and all of those people, I shouldn't say all of those people, but I would venture to guess a large majority of those people, that's the only console they have. They only have a Switch or a Switch Lite, and they only play Nintendo games. And the sort of more mainstream audience is going to be after the Switch, which I think could present some problems for us hardcore Nintendo people. I do think, or I should say, I do hope that the two other consoles, the Xbox and the PlayStation 5, are more readily available by holiday, just because I don't want people to have to go through
that horror again. We also have to consider that a lot of these shortages that were happening last year in this holiday season were due to COVID and different suppliers not being able to produce what they could. And it looks like things are getting better.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Yeah. I think things are getting better, but I also think it's not going to be, you know, if COVID had never happened, you know, I don't think we're going to be reaching that level this year. Mm-hmm. I think it's just the domino effect of everything falling down, and it's going to be a long time before they can, you know, sort of pick those back up and get back up to speed. But yeah,
I guess now everyone is more prepared with protocols in place to counteract the difficulties that COVID has caused as well. Whereas last year, like, everyone just kind of had to start from scratch. So
yeah, that's also true.
A little bit better.
I mean, I have to be honest. I really hope that if it does come out holiday 2020, and there's a lot of credible rumors that it will be, and it's going to be $50 to $100 more than the existing Switch. If I'm being completely honest, as much as I hope that there are enough for everybody, I hope there's at least one for me. And I have to be honest and true to everyone, because I really want, I'm going to buy it. Come on, there's, look at me.
The interesting thing about this rumor too, or this kind of continued rumor, is it confirms, if true, obviously, it confirms why they would be going 4K Switch, right? Because it's going to have actually better graphics capabilities. But then also the kind of like most unexpected part to me about this report from Bloomberg is that they also said it's going to come alongside a like slew of games that are like supposed
right and Nintendo said as much it. That they have unannounced blockbuster titles coming
right
out.
Yeah, and so like that earlier Nintendo Direct recently, which was like good but not like a gangbuster of a thing recently, mm-hmm. where everyone was like, oh, that's kind of all that's your 2021, like, okay, that's cool, but you know, not as much as I'm expecting. It could be that it's because they're waiting to announce some things alongside this, which would be really cool and really exciting. Also would make a lot of people want to buy this system
Breath of the Wild 2. Yeah. That's the day one game that comes out.
I think Pokemon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl are the day one game if this thing comes out.
They did say at least that more Zelda news is coming this year, right? So like,
yeah,
it's really, I don't know. I'm just very curious what all that stuff is going to be. It could be the answer to why we didn't get as much during that direct.
I also know that Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl are slated to come out first. I don't know if they specified a quarter. I don't remember, but they said 2022. So if that were to be a launch title, then we wouldn't be getting the Super Nintendo Switch.
Wait, the remakes aren't coming until 2022?
So they're... Oh, sorry.
I was thinking of Pokemon Legends.
I'm sorry. They're both in Sinnoh. So I got to mix up. No, I apologize. I'm very tired. I'm sorry.
Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl are whatever the order of those two things is not exactly the like graphical prettiest powerhouse of a thing that you would want to go off immediately, a 4K system.
Yeah, that's why my brain immediately went to Pokemon Legends, because that could potentially be a really pretty game when it's done.
Yeah.
But
not that those remakes look bad.
No.
They look good. They just are not what I would expect from a, like, here's this brand new, stronger console that we want to show off the capabilities of.
Yeah, it's not going to push the hardware whatsoever.
Right.
Being a chibi top-down Pokemon game. Yeah, not what you think of.
A chibi top-down Zelda game sure pushed the hardware, so.
Yeah, it broke it.
Boom, right there. That was your free Nintendo voice chat bingo slot. We're talking about the Super Nintendo Switch. More credible rumors. Holiday 2021. $50 to $100 more, possibly. We'll see. Wait and see. Who knows what next week will bring? I have an idea, though. It'll bring more news about it. One more thing. Super Nintendo World is open in Tokyo, Japan. IGN Japan went there and reviewed a theme park, which I think might be the first theme park review that IGN has ever done.
Not sure.
We might have done. I think we did Star Wars before.
Oh, Galaxy's Edge.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. Which also I still haven't been to. But from the review, this is all in quotes. Super Nintendo World brilliantly reinvents and gamifies the theme park experience while offering an unprecedented level of immersion and, most importantly, fun. It's a fitting tribute to Super Mario on the series' 35th anniversary that will fill your heart with joy. 9 out of 10. That's amazing. My heart, I don't know, but I can't speak for yours, but my heart needs a little more joy into it. However, the bad news is Japan has some pretty strict travel regulations still in effect, so you're not going to be able to go at this time. But
which is made even more disappointing by the fact that they're shutting down and tearing it all down on March 31st, 2021.
I was waiting to jump in and say that, Tom.
Low hanging fruit. I'm sorry.
Oh, man.
This review was from Daniel Robson out of the chief editor,
IGN Japan. Yep.
Yeah. And he got to go on like a press tour with a bunch of press people got to go kind of toured through with Nintendo or by the park creators. They got like 4.5 hours in the park. It was all COVID protected. And yeah, he said he could have stayed there all day. Right. And it's just
hiding in a warp pipe. Hopefully nobody notices you.
It's cool to see he had so much fun with it.
Yeah.
Should go check out that article because the screenshots in there are, they're not screenshots, photos of real places are very cool.
Remember those real places?
I know.
Oh my God. That was crazy. So that was a Super Nintendo World review. Check that review out. It's by IGN Japan and they thought it was amazing. And I mean, how could they not? But real quick, out this week. Last week, I didn't realize that Tom and I have a different definition of the week. I was doing the week upcoming, and he does the week that we just had. So Tales from the Borderlands is out. That is $25. Overcooked All You Can Eat is out. Story of Seasons, Pioneers of Olive Town, who Rebecca, who was on last week, she reviewed it. She gave it a 7. She said Story of Seasons, Pioneers of Olive Town is familiar comfort food for farming game lovers and plenty of it. She gave that a 7. $50. She gave The New Harvest Moon a 5, which was not good. You know, you're not going to want to harvest that one. But of course, tomorrow, Monster Hunter Rise comes out. I'm sure that that's on all of our SD cards right now, because I, after playing it, the demo, I turned it on. I asked Parker, I was like, you're interested in this? He goes, nah, I don't know. And then I played it and he said, actually, I think we should pre-order this. So
yes.
I pre-ordered it for him. Nice. But, I mean, also, I want to keep playing it. Balan Wonderland. Or, God, Wonder why World. Do I say that every time? Wonder World.
Wonder World.
Comes out tomorrow. That is also $60. And K's in the Wild Masks, which is a cool looking retro platformer.
Yeah, Seth, you might be into that one, actually. It's kind of it's like nine. It spills itself as like kind of like a 90s style 2D side scrolling platformer. It's got like Sonic vibes or that sort of world. It just looks cool. So I thought I'd shout it out. Also, really quickly, one thing I did want to say, just as kind of like a word of caution on Balan Wonderworld, there's already a demo of that game out, which you can try yourself. So you don't have to take my word for it. I thought the demo was pretty terrible.
Yeah, it is awful.
And I can at least tell you that IGN has not received review code yet. So we will not have a review.
Maybe it's COVID. Tomorrow. That's why. That's
sure.
Can't jump to conclusions.
You know what other game we also didn't receive code for? Harvest Moon.
Ooh. Right.
Oh.
Yeah. And to be fair, I've said this on the show many times. Just because you get code the day of does not mean, or you don't get code before
right.
launch,
that's
does not,
not
mean the game is bad.
Yeah.
That's kind of an old wives' tale of a thing. You get code at different times for all different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just saying this because we will not have pre-release coverage of that game as far as I know. And the demo was, what's a good word? Abysmal is how
atrocious.
I meant. Yeah, thought it was pretty
that
terrible.
Harsh.
So yeah,
more like Blunder World.
But yeah, I just wanted to make sure that was said because it'll probably be out by the time a lot of people are listening to this.
Oh, that's a bummer. All right, well, yeah, Monster Hunter Rise comes out tomorrow. Balan Wonderworld comes out tomorrow, and K's in the Wild Masks also comes out tomorrow, and you can check those out if you kind of want to. Narita Boy, I put on there in error, so we're going to skip over that one, because that one's not till next week, and I kickstarted that one like 4 years ago or whenever it was, and I'm very excited to play. I'm going to skip over what we've been playing, because I already know what everyone's been playing, or what is going to be in the future for everyone to be playing, because I want to get to the question block to get some questions answered from our listeners and viewers. These are some pretty good questions this week. So Sunny Vaughn asks, with a newly formed partnership between Nintendo and Niantic, Pikmin AR is on the way. Which of Nintendo's franchises do you want Niantic to give a go next? Personally, he says, I wouldn't mind a Zelda AR game where you collect rupees, Koroks, equipment, etc., and you go visit shrines, dungeons, where you need to solve some sort of puzzle, and maybe some bubble clients. Yeah, that's my answer. I think that was easy. All right, next. Casey. Can't think of one? Everyone's thinking. I'm just going to vamp.
I don't know.
Animal Crossing would not be a terrible one.
Oh, yeah, that'd be kind of cute and fun.
I'll be frank. I'm not a huge fan of Niantic style AR walk around the world games. Not that I have anything against them. It's just like not totally my cup of tea, but I could see a fun one of like turning your actual neighborhood into an Animal Crossing neighborhood would be kind of cute.
That would be super cute.
Yeah. Go ahead, Logan.
I think this news is really weird, the partnership with Nintendo and Niantic, because it's obviously they're trying to recapture some of that Pokemon Go magic, and I just don't think they're going to, because nothing's as big as Pokemon, and nothing works as well in that gameplay style as Pokemon. So I think my answer is I'm probably not really going to get into any of these games through this partnership. I think that Pokemon Go was a lightning in a bottle moment that summer of 2016 when it came out. And
was it that long ago? Oh my God.
It was. Yeah. And I just don't really see it happening again. I think that, I don't know. I kind of feel like this is a really weird piece of news. I don't see millions of people downloading a Pikmin game and walking around with Pikmin. It's just really weird to me. I think Zelda could be cool, but I'd rather just play Zelda on my Switch or or somewhere else.
I'm gonna play the kind of one because I love Pikmin.
Mm-hmm. They're gonna be the kind of games that I download and check out for a day, and then
don't
look at again. I mean, my attention span with mobile games is abysmal. Word of the day. except for the one time I got really into Puzzle and Dragons, and that was not an AR game. I guess I did get kind of into Pokemon Go when it first came out for that summer, but I was fatigued after a couple of months, especially after they took out the tracking mechanic. So
yeah. Yeah. But then again, you got some people like former news editor Andrew Goldfarb,
yes,
who still, he's collected all of them and all their little hats and different ones, and he's still playing it. And to sort of go on Logan's point about how Pokemon, wait, who made the point about Pokemon being the driving
lightning
factor
in a bottle?
It? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, Logan. Yeah, that game pretty much existed in a different form before that. And I can't remember what it was called, and it was only like certain weird geocaching people. I shouldn't say that.
Oh, it was on Google Maps. It was like a Google Maps.
Yeah, I can't remember what the name of it was, but it was, I mean, it's not the same. You didn't go around catching things, but it was sort of a GPS sort of driven game in the same vein. And very few people played it. Throw some Pokemon in there, boom, everybody was going bananas. Throw some Pikmin on there, I'll try it.
Wait. You're talking about
Egress. Niantic's, that's what it was called.
A Niantic's previous game, yeah.
Yes.
And something else weird about this is that Nintendo just like totally pulled out of the mobile market. They just basically said, hey, we're not going to make any more games. And yeah, they're partnering with Niantic, so Niantic can make the games. But Nintendo on mobile just never really worked for me. And I think it's their strategy of really wanting to provide premium value to the customer. It's at that premium price usually on console of $60. But on mobile, the nickel and diming, I think Nintendo was uncomfortable with that. There were reports that DNA, who they partnered with to make mobile games last time, was pushing Nintendo to up the microtransaction game. And Nintendo told the developers, hey, keep it down. Keep the microtransactions down because we don't want to screw over our customer base. A lot of kids play Nintendo games and they don't like that payment model. So this is really surprising news to me in general to see them dive back into that pool. Granted, in a very different way. It's not the gacha style game like Fire Emblem Heroes was, but I'm just overall surprised to see them dip back into that pool that I kind of thought they were shifting away from.
Yeah. Yeah, I know that they had that conversation with the Dragalia Lost as well. And honestly, I thought Dragalia Lost was good. I thought Fire Emblem Heroes was good. I thought, you know, Mario Run was, they were good mobile games. I still want Dragalia Lost, like an actual Switch game of it. I liked it. But
that would be
attention span's too short.
that'd be pretty cool, actually. Yeah, I definitely played basically all the Nintendo mobile games. But yeah, it's like you said, they just didn't. Still work. They're premium. It's like, you know, I don't want to play a little bite-sized version of Mario. I want to play Mario. Mm-hmm. I don't want to play a little weird Mario Kart. Although actually Mario Kart on the phone is better than it should be. But so there's your answer, Sunny Vaughn. I'm sorry, but we've decided we all hate our phones.
Getting rid of hate it.
Joshua Hodgeboom. I'm not sure if I'm saying that right. I'm sorry if I messed up your name.
Finally, someone else is in the hot seat.
It's the worst. Okay. wants to know, what is the best weapon / strategy in Rise for a newbie to the Monster Hunter series? And I have a personal interest in the same question because I would like to know. Casey, I defer to you, the guide's Monster Hunter expert.
The best strategy as a newbie to Monster Hunter Rise is to go to IGN's Beginner's Guide for Monster Hunter Rise on our wiki page.
Plug. Synergy, did you see that?
But also, I would say there are a couple of weapons that I think are good for beginners. I always tell people to start with the Sword and Shield. I think it's very versatile. You don't need to manage any gauges or like anything in particular. You can use items with your weapon out if you use the radial menu or if you're a guardian at the same time. The Rise has added a few more interesting mechanics to the Sword and Shield this time around, but it's fine. You don't need to know about them to play. And I know that dual blades do have some gauge that you have to manage, but it's pretty simple. And I think anyone who's used to video games will get used to it quite quickly. I also think if you like heavier and slower weapons, I think hammer is a pretty decent one as well. Logan and Tom, please chime in if you disagree.
I'm gonna write this down. Hammer.
If you want to look the best and look really cool, then you should play Switch X because it's the coolest.
Yeah, but maybe also not the best for.
That's what I started with when I started Monster Hunter, and I've never gone back.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough. I think that is a testament to part of what we were saying earlier, though, too, is like, if you just pick something and just like try it and just keep playing with it, you'll get better at it no matter what you pick.
Go ahead, Tom.
What I was going to say is, Casey already mentioned it, but I usually, when I am talking to completely new players, recommend the dual blades just because they are the fastest weapon. So you can dodge a lot more than you would. Like, you can break out of animations quicker than you would with a lot of the other weapons. And it's a lot less reliant on like being in the exact right spot when you start your attacks to deal the damage. And like you said, the bar that you charge up is kind of an added layer of nuance whenever you want it, but like, frankly, in the very early beginning of that game, you can completely ignore the demon gauge on the dual blades and just sort of like hit stuff and learn what you're doing and then like engage with that system once you're ready to later.
And cool. Monster Hunter Rise starts you out with all 14 weapons already in your box, so you can take them all to the training area and just try them out until you find one that you vibe with.
Yeah, mess around.
It was a little overwhelming in the demo. I was like, Parker, what do I do? He's like,
take it to the, so the training area is cool because it shows you the combos as you do them, and it shows you like what you can do with your weapon on screen. So you can kind of like, even I like go back there sometimes because I do something out in the field. I'm like, how the heck did I just do that really cool thing? And I'll go back in the training area and I'll be like, that's how I do it, because it shows you your button inputs.
When I was playing the demo, I was fighting the intermediate monster who shoots the bubbles. And I did a wire bug up a wall, and I did a backflip just as he was like, I dodged from this backflip, and I was like, oh, I wish I had actually done that on purpose, because that was so amazing. So I'm looking forward to more stuff like that. Let's see, I think we have time for one more.
Neil Patrick, I did use the Switch X and try in 3 Ultimate. It is a very good weapon. Okay.
I didn't mean to hate. I use a very complicated weapon also in the insect glaive, and I just, I'll shut up.
Neil Patrick Malari asks, for the people who love Monster Hunter series, which is the entire panel, in what Monster Hunter game and in what moment in that game did you know that you love or will love this series? Casey.
I was playing the very first one, and I was playing online at like 2 o'clock in the morning over the summer, and some random person on the internet who I had been playing with in a certain room, that's the way online worked, decided to take time to teach me how to headlock with the lance. Didn't know this person, but took time out of the day to teach someone who had no idea what she was doing how to do this really complicated mechanic, and did it for hours. So
that's awesome.
Thank you, Monster Hunter community. That was very cool.
Oh, man. Logan, and the person, what about you?
The person who introduced me to Monster Hunter in high school, who I was dating at the time, we're still friends, and he texted me and my current fiance that he's excited to play with us this weekend. So, you know, Monster Hunter transcends all those friendships. Okay, go.
For me, it was fighting. World was actually my first Monster Hunter. I've gone back through the series since then, but World is when I got really into it. And it was fighting the Diablos, and it was just kicking me and my friend's butt. And we put the game down for a while and did this deep dive on YouTube videos and strategies and just learned so much information about this game. And we just really became driven to just become those guys. You fire the SOS flare and these people roll into your hunt and just dominate the monster for you, and we're like, we want to be that good. And so it's just that drive that Monster Hunter is really a game that you can, if you invest into it, you can just become so skilled at it. And I thought that was really, really cool. It almost felt like playing games when you're a kid where you're just like beating your head against the wall until something clicks. And I think it was that Diablos fight in the main story of World where it really clicked for me.
Nice. Tom, real quick, we have less than a minute.
Okay, well, so I got into Monster Hunter through World, really, but the moment I knew that I really liked the series was actually way back with, I think it was Monster Hunter Tri, with a friend at a friend's house, just being like, wait, so all you do in this game is fight giant things, like bigger things than I'd ever seen in an action game up until that point. And I was like, yeah, I want to get into this. And then I just never did until World, because it felt very hard to get into, dense to get mm-hmm. into. But I'm very glad I did. I'm very glad I've gone back like Logan and played some of the other ones since. And it's hard to get over just the feeling of fighting something 10 times the size of you, basically.
For sure.
Well, I'm very excited. I'm hoping that maybe this will be my Monster Hunter moment, because like I said in the demo, it almost clicked. Like, it was right there on the edge. And I was like, I just wish I had more time. So I'll check back with you next time I'm on. But that is all the time we have for this week. I want to thank my panel, and I will let everyone know that Casey will be back in the hosting chair tomorrow, so she can mess up your name and not me, which is very exciting for me. This is NVC, the only podcast where you can
get the thing.
Well, that was NVC. It was a whole heck of a lot of fun. We are on the IGN Games YouTube channel. As always, I am now joined by Damon Hetfield, the professional podcast mm-hmm. host who knows what channel we're on. He's going to tell us about Game Scoop.
Oh, Seth, Game Scoop is going to be great tomorrow. Of course, this is IGN's podcast that talks about everything going on in video games. We're going to talk a lot about Nintendo stuff this week, because the latest rumors about the Nintendo Switch Pro must be addressed. And assuming those rumors are real, I want to know, is it enough? Is this NVIDIA chip with DLSS, is it enough to keep it relevant alongside PlayStation 5 and Xbox Series X? And does Nintendo even need this? Is anybody looking for this when the Nintendo continues to sell phenomenally well? That's going to be our main topic this week. But Seth, we also play Video Game 20 Questions at the end of every episode. And just as a little teaser, let's play 5 questions right now. 5 questions. And this is a game that I know you love. Let the questioning begin.
Is this a Nintendo platform game?
Yes.
Is this a game before 1990?
Yes.
Is this a Capcom game?
No.
Oh, well, this is going to be a little bit tougher now. Is this a published by Nintendo game?
No. And that's it. You're down to your guess. Remember your hint. Remember your hint.
It was a Nintendo platform game before 1990. It's a game that I love. There's so many games that I love. I am going to say Contra.
It is. Ah, it is. You've won your very first game of 5 questions. Nicely job.